sign of our anticipation of the Word of God. Genesis chapter 43 this morning. Genesis chapter 43. Now the famine was severe in the land. So it came about, when they had finished eating the grain which they had brought from Egypt, that their father said to them, "Go back, buy us a little food." Judah spoke to him, however, saying, "The man solemnly warned us, 'You shall not see my face unless your brother is with you. If you send our brother with us, we will go down and buy you food. But if you do not send him, we will not go down. For the man said to us, "You will not see my face until your brother is with you."' Then Israel said, 'Why did you treat me so badly by telling the man whether you still had another brother?' But they said, 'The man questioned particularly about us and our relatives, saying, "Is your father still alive? Have you another brother?" So we answered his questions. Could we possibly know that he would say, 'Bring your brother down?' Judah said to his father Israel, 'Send the lad with me, and we will arise and go, that we may live and not die, we as well as you and our little ones. I myself will be surety for him. You may hold me responsible for him. If I do not bring him back to you and set him before you, then let me bear the blame before you forever. For if we had not delayed, surely by now we could have returned twice.' Then their father Israel said to them, 'If it must be so, then do this. Take some of the best products of the land in your bags and carry down to the man as a present a little balm and a little honey, aromatic gum and myrrh, pistachio nuts and almonds.'" Who can resist pistachios? "Take double the money in your hand, and take back in your hand the money that was returned in the mouth of your sacks. Perhaps it was a mistake. Take your brother also, and arise, return to the man, and may God Almighty grant you compassion in the sight of the man, so that he will release to you your other brother and Benjamin. And as for me, if I am bereaved of my children, I am bereaved." So the men took this present, and they took double the money in their hand and Benjamin. Then they arose and went down to Egypt and stood before Joseph. When Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to his house steward, "Bring the men into the house and slay an animal and make ready, for the men are to dine with me at noon." So the man did as Joseph said and brought the men to Joseph's house. Now the men were afraid, because they were brought to Joseph's house. And they said, "It is because of the money that was returned in our sacks the first time that we are being brought in, that he may seek occasion against us and fall upon us and take us for slaves with our donkeys." So they came near to Joseph's house steward and spoke to him at the entrance of the house and said, "O my lord, we indeed came down the first time to buy food, and it came about when we came to the lodging place that we opened our sacks, and behold, each man's money was in the mouth of his sack, our money in full. So we have brought it back in our hand. We have also brought down other money in our hand to buy food. We do not know who put our money in our sacks." He said, "Be at ease, do not be afraid. Your God and the God of your father has given you treasure in your sacks. I had your money." Then he brought Simeon out to them. Then the man brought the men into Joseph's house and gave them water, and they washed their feet, and he gave their donkeys fodder. So they prepared the present for Joseph's coming at noon, for they had heard that they were to eat a meal there. When Joseph came home, they brought into the house to him the present which was in their hand and bowed to the ground before him. Then he asked them about their welfare and said, "Is your old father well, of whom you spoke? Is he still alive?" They said, "Your servant, our father, is well. He is still alive." They bowed down in homage. As he lifted his eyes and saw his brother Benjamin, his mother's son, he said, "Is this your youngest brother of whom you spoke to me?" And he said, "May God be gracious to you, my son." And Joseph hurried out, for he was deeply stirred over his brother, and he sought a place to weep. And he entered his chamber and wept there. Then he washed his face and came out, and he controlled himself and said, "Serve the meal." So they served him by himself and them by themselves, and the Egyptians who ate with him by themselves, because the Egyptians could not eat bread with the Hebrews, for that is loathsome to the Egyptians. Now they were seated before him, the firstborn according to his birthright, and the youngest according to his youth, and the men looked at one another in astonishment. He took portions to them from his own table, but Benjamin's portion was 5 times as much as any of theirs. So they feasted and drank freely with him. Our gracious God and Father, there is so much here in this portion of Joseph's story. Father, open our hearts to that which you would have us to see and understand. Glorify yourself, Father, in your word today. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. Well, we have spent some time in the story of Joseph's life to this point, and we have seen in all of the accounts of Joseph's experience 2 overarching purposes in God's providence, which have become apparent. First of all, the story of Joseph tells us how Israel will end up in Egypt in the first place. So that Genesis chapter 15, verses 13 and 14 will be fulfilled. And secondly, it explains how the promise of God in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, in the Abrahamic covenant, would be fulfilled. That is, how God would make the family of Abraham into a great nation. In accomplishing all of this, God would, in his providence, use famine to bring his family down into Egypt. And that story continues here in our text this morning. There are 3 different scenes in this one chapter that is before us. First, in verses 1 through 10, where the brothers plead with their father to allow them to take Benjamin down to Egypt once again to rescue their brother Simeon, who has been imprisoned there awaiting their return, and also to purchase more food because the famine continues. In verses 11 through 14, we see Jacob, or here called Israel, finally relenting and giving in and giving instruction to the brothers concerning what they are to do on their way back to Egypt and what they are to do once they get there. And then in verses 15 through 34, we have this somewhat strange scene where the 11 brothers are reunited, unbeknownst to them, with their brother Joseph. So let's take each of these in turn and see what the Lord would have to say to us this morning. The first thing we see here in verses 1 through 10 is God's continued but gracious discipline. Here the brothers, and especially Judah, again plead with their father Israel to allow them to take Benjamin down to the land of Egypt. And we see the continuation of God's providential hand of discipline upon them. Now we understand, of course, as we begin, that when we talk about God's discipline, we are talking about a good thing. We are talking about an expression of God's grace, even as he brings difficult things into the lives of his people. Hebrews chapter 12 makes it very clear that God disciplines those whom he loves. He desires good for us as a father desires good for his children. And a good, loving father who desires good for his children will not withhold discipline from his children, for he is aware that the lack of discipline will lead to strife and lead to difficult times. It will not produce the good that he desires in his children. Well, God is the ultimate loving father who disciplines his children, and we're seeing that here. So we need to understand as we begin this that the discipline of God is a gracious act flowing out of his love for his people. Look at the opening words of the chapter. Now the famine was severe in the land, and so we're seeing the continuation of the providence of God's discipline in the famine. We're seeing the continuation of God's discipline in the continued imprisonment of Simeon. We don't know how long they have been gone. It could not have been a short trip. It's just not a day or two going from Egypt back home to Canaan. It's been some time just to travel back home. They went back home, you'll remember, with bags full of food, and now we find that the food is running out. So it's been some time. Simeon has been sitting in prison for quite a while. And then, of course, there are these strident words of Jacob, which show us the tensions which still exist in this family and give us some sort of taste of what these young men have run up against in terms of their relationship with their father. They have given us a taste of the bitterness remaining in the heart of Jacob himself. There are several things worth noting here. As we mentioned, first of all, in verses 1 and 2, we see the famine has continued in its severity. And though they have been given food to take home with them, the famine is nonetheless a threat to the entire family. The food is running out. They need more of it. And its very severity is forcing Jacob now to reconsider his previous position. You'll remember that when the brothers came home and told Jacob all that had happened in Egypt and requested that they be allowed to take Benjamin and return to Egypt in order to rescue their brother Simeon, their father would not permit it. Well, hungry bellies have a way of changing minds. And that seems to be the catalyst here. God, in his sovereign providence, is going to accomplish his purposes, and he is doing so through a famine. Reuben had begged Jacob to allow his children, Reuben's own children, to stand in the place of Benjamin as a guarantee that he would return with the boy alive after taking him back to Egypt. But Jacob has refused, but now reconsiders. In the midst of the severity of the famine, he comes to his sons and he asks them to help. And in verses 3 through 5, Judah now steps forward as the spokesman and reminds his father of the predicament. Perhaps Reuben decided, I tried once and he rebuffed me. Let someone else give it a shot. And so Judah steps up and says, listen, Dad, we cannot go back to Egypt to get the grain if we don't take Benjamin. The man gave us explicit instructions not to show our faces before him again unless our brother was there. Their integrity had been questioned, and it was absolutely impossible for them now to do otherwise. In verse 6, Jacob seems to be overwhelmed. Look at what he says there in verse 6. Then Israel, Jacob said, why did you treat me so badly by telling the man whether you still had another brother? There's this tone of self-pity there. He's been treated badly by everyone. He doesn't recognize that God is involved here and God is working out his plan. The brothers, they jointly answer together there in verse 7 and explain their actions. And they remind him what happened the last time they were in Egypt. The man questioned particularly about us and our relatives, saying, is your father still alive? Have you another brother? And we understand when that happened, we know what Joseph was getting at. Joseph would not have asked these questions to just anyone. He was looking for news of his own father and his own brother. This is the first time that we've discovered that this was part of the conversation. This hadn't been brought out earlier. Joseph is inquiring specifically about the state of those who were not there standing before him in Egypt. They don't know that this Egyptian is inquiring about his own father, but that's exactly what he's doing. And he's inquiring about his brother Benjamin, and we see something there of the yearning of Joseph's heart. Joseph had said, "Lord, I thank you that you have allowed me to forget where I have come from. You've allowed me to forget the family that was once mine," but we find that that really isn't true. Joseph may have pushed all of that to the back of his mind, but here when he's confronted with his brothers, even the brothers that had sold him off into slavery, yet still these memories come and he's overwhelmed and he wants to know, "How's Dad? How's Benjamin?" So Moses is doing a lot of things at once here. He's showing us a little bit about the struggle that Joseph is now experiencing. Once Joseph had been exalted to his high position, as we say, he had thanked God that he had forgotten his father's household. But now it all comes rushing back, and we find that he's never forgotten. He's still considering these things. He's still thinking of his father and his brother. And then the brothers, having explained their actions, Judah once again in verses 8 and 9 steps up and pledges himself as a surety for the protection of his half-brother Benjamin. Verse 9, "I myself will be surety for him." It's a great picture of what surety means. It's not really a word we use very much anymore. What is surety? A surety, particularly in this context, is one who stands in for another and takes upon himself whatever that other person's penalty might be. It's not hard to see Jesus here, is it? This is what our Lord has done. He has become surety for us. He stepped in to our place and took upon himself on the cross the penalty that we rightly deserve. That's the gospel here in Genesis. As I was preparing to step up into the pulpit this morning and just thinking about the language that I would use to introduce the message, the phrase came into my head and I had to think about it a moment or two, why that was. But instead of just thinking about the book of Genesis and asking you to turn to the book of Genesis, I kept thinking in my mind, the gospel of Genesis. Well, Genesis isn't a gospel. It's Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Those are gospels, not Genesis. But the gospel is here in Genesis, in many different places and in many different forms, and here's one. After all, if you didn't see it right away, perhaps you'll see it when I point out that it is Judah who is speaking about being this surety, the head of the tribe from which the Messiah will come. There's a reason why it's not Reuben stepping forth again. There's a reason in the plans and purposes and sovereignty of God that it is Judah who steps up and says, "I'll be the surety," because we are supposed to see in Judah a picture of Christ, the son of Judah. And so here in Genesis chapter 43, we're seeing God's providence bringing all of the brothers to Egypt. Surely their father's response to them, both on their initial return and then their departure back to Egypt, had been a form of discipline for these brothers as well. It must have been a difficult thing to face the accusations and suspicion of their father. But it is ironic, isn't it? Jacob had good reason to be suspicious of his sons. But the irony is that he displays this suspicion when his sons are finally trying to act with integrity. They're finally trying to do the right thing. And now their father comes out with this kind of harsh suspicion toward them. They had come and they had told him exactly what had happened. They're willing to risk their own lives and the lives of their children to rescue their imprisoned brother. And yet it's now that Jacob brings these accusations. And by the way, it does show us something about the consequences of sin, does it not? How many of us heard from our parents as we were growing up about the dangers of crying wolf? There's something of that nature going on here. The same kind of thing is true when it comes to our character. You know, the story about crying wolf, there's the shepherd boy, and he keeps trying to fool everyone in the village, and he keeps crying out, "There's a wolf, there's a wolf," and everybody comes running out, and of course there is no wolf, he's just playing a trick on them. And then finally, there really is a wolf, and nobody believes him. Once you have given others a reason to mistrust you and to question your character, changing that perception is a long and difficult process. It can be done, and we certainly believe in the process of sanctification. God takes us where we are, and He changes us. We can be changed. We believe that people can change. We believe that God does, in fact, change us. But we need to realize how serious this is. We need to realize that we will change long before others' perception of us will change. This is why, young people, it is so important to guard your reputation and your character. You can lose it in a moment, and it can take a lifetime to recover. Here the brothers are showing signs of real change, real growth, and yet the father is still suspicious, and you can't really blame him. Here is a broken-hearted man. And yet the Lord is using all of it, and the Lord will use all of it for His glory, for the good of His people. He's using all of this to prepare the way for a great reconciliation. That's what is to come. Well, as we continue on and look at verses 11 through 14, you see Jacob relent from his refusal to commit Benjamin to his other sons. He sets forth a plan for them, and he commits himself to the sovereignty of God by lifting up a prayer of trust. Verse 11, we read that their father Israel said to them, "If it must be so, then do this. Take some of the best products of the land in your bags and carry down to the man as a present, a little balm and a little honey, aromatic gum, myrrh, pistachio nuts, and almonds. Take double the money in your hand and take back in your hand the money that was returned in the mouth of your sacks. Perhaps it was a mistake. Take your brother also and arise and return to the man. And may God Almighty grant you compassion in the sight of the man so that he will release to you your other brother and Benjamin. As for me, if I am bereaved of my children, I am bereaved." And so he's placing all of his hope, his whole future, in the hands of the Almighty God. In fact, you cannot get a better definition of biblical saving faith than the action of Jacob here in this passage. He's letting go of everything and relying, completely trusting in God Almighty. And so he relents, and he gives three specific instructions. He tells the son, first of all, take a present. Now, that would have been absolute protocol in those days. If you had approached a high official, you would have been expected to take some sort of present with you and to offer that to him. Now, these presents don't seem like very extravagant gifts, perhaps. Balm, honey, aromatic gum, myrrh, pistachio nuts, and almonds. But remember, we're in the midst of a famine. These kinds of gifts probably cost them a great deal. And then in verse 12, Jacob says to take double the money that you took last time. Because that money was returned, you'll remember, was put in their sacks, unbeknownst to them. And so he had every intention of them going, presenting themselves, giving that money back. And he gives them double the money in case they need extra. Perhaps having not been paid the first time, the Egyptians will jack up the price the second time. Jacob doesn't know what they're going to find. Perhaps because as the famine has gone on and the food supply dwindles, perhaps the price has gone up as well. The demand has risen, so you would expect the price to rise. Whatever the case, he gives them the money that they got back the first time, plus double what they had taken before. And then thirdly, in verse 13, he says, now, take Benjamin. Take Benjamin. He finally comes around to understand we have no other choice. We have to risk everything or we will die. Now, these are prudent and wise decisions that Jacob is finally making. He considers the situation. He does what is wise and proper, but he doesn't stop there. He doesn't place his trust in these strategies, the strategy of the presents and the returned money and meeting whatever demands the Egyptian officials may impose. Ultimately, we find he puts his trust in God. This is what we see in verse 14. May God Almighty grant you compassion in the sight of the man, so that he will release to you your other brother and Benjamin. If you want to see, I want you to see here three things about this prayer that he lifts up. First of all, notice the title that he uses when he addresses the Lord. God Almighty. That is the name in which God had come to his grandfather Abraham back in Genesis chapter 17 when he had made the promise to Abraham that he would give him a seed. Now that is so significant because you see what Jacob's about to do. He's about to send every son that he has down to Egypt with no guarantee that any of them would ever return. And so he calls on the name God Almighty, El Shaddai. May he be gracious. The second, notice what he asks for. He asks that God Almighty would grant them compassion in the sight of the man, that is Joseph. This is a testimony to Jacob's theology of providence. He knows that even the heart of the Egyptians are held in the hand of his God, God Almighty. He knows that this God, his God, the God of his father, can cause those Egyptians to look favorably upon his sons. His confidence is not in his own plans and strategies. His confidence is in his God. And so he prays that God would cause them, that God would intervene, that God would turn the heart of this Egyptian official to do that which he desires, to look favorably upon his sons. to show them favor and to bless them. And then finally, notice this. There are these words of resignation, this last statement in verse 14. As for me, if I am bereaved of my children, I am bereaved. And when we first read those words, they sound so pessimistic. They sound almost to be a contradiction of what he has just said. First, you have this burst of faith, God Almighty, you can do this, I leave it with you. And then this very pessimistic outlook, which seems contrary to the trust that he had just expressed. But remember what's happening here. Once again, we're seeing God require a patriarch to risk everything in order to gain the promise. Was there doubt mixed with Jacob's faith? Sure there was, just like there is with ours. We look back at these great biblical people, and sometimes we forget they were people. They were flesh and blood like us. And if you can look back over your life and your relationship with God and what he has done for you and in you and what he has brought you through, then you will recognize the same things in Jacob that you see in yourself. And that is that we are always a mixture, aren't we? There is always faith and sometimes a little doubt. There is faith and oftentimes a good bit of fear. We trust, we know what we know about God. We know who he is and how he works and what he's going to accomplish. We understand his promises and we believe his promises. And yet, because we are still fallen people, because we are not yet perfected, we are not yet sanctified, all of that faith is always mixed with fear and with doubt. And that's what we find. That's what we find in Jacob. Ultimately, though, this whole section demonstrates not his doubt and fear, but his absolute trust in God. In spite of his doubt, in spite of his fear, he still sends them. His trust overcomes. That's what we need to learn. Not to listen to the voices of doubt and fear, but listen to the heart of faith that God has given to us. Remember how God has worked in our lives in the past and act on the basis of what we know to be true, though we may not be able to see it in the moment. And here, what we're seeing here is, in essence, a definition of faith. He's placing his whole trust in God. Everything is in God's hands now. How long would he have to wait before he would hear whether or not his hopes had been dashed or fulfilled? How long would he have to wait for his sons to return from Egypt, if they ever would? He had no way of knowing. But he acted upon what he knew about his God, and he trusted. God, in his providence, in the rest of this chapter, uses Joseph's kindness now to bring another kind of discipline upon these brothers, to convict his brothers, and to prepare their hearts and the heart of his father. Look in verses 15 through 34. You see the 11 brothers in their encounter with Joseph receiving a surprisingly lavish gift of hospitality from him. And again, we see God's providence working on both Joseph and his brothers to effect a future reconciliation and to advance his own sovereign plan. Moses is focusing on two sides of this story. He's going to continue to give us glimpses into the person of Joseph. We see his kindness and his brokenness and his desire for reconciliation in spite of all that his brothers had done. And then in regard to the brothers, we see more of their guilty conscience through their suspicion and about how to understand these kind gestures that are being offered to them. We see the fearfulness exhibited throughout this experience. And at the same time, we also see their developing integrity and their increasing fear of God. We see these men changing before us on the pages of Scripture, just as God changes us day by day and year by year. Look at verse 16 to begin with. When Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to his house steward, "Bring the men into the house and slay an animal and make ready, for the men are to dine with me at noon." Joseph, upon setting eyes upon his brother Benjamin, tells the steward, "Take these guys to my own house and prepare the meal. I'm going to eat with them there." And so he's extending this extraordinary hospitality to his brothers. But their response is not what he had hoped, I'm sure. This act of kindness produces fear in them. They start speaking to one another, and look at what they say. "It's because of the money that was returned in our sacks. Now they're going to take us all as slaves, and you know what? They're probably going to take our donkeys too," which is just a weird thing to say, isn't it? Remember, this is the Lord of Egypt, second only to Pharaoh. I don't think he needed a few Hebrew donkeys to enrich himself. It's amazing the way the mind works under pressure, isn't it? What's going on here? I think Calvin is correct when he says that this is the guilty conscience of the brothers working upon them. Their consciences are wounded and incredibly sensitive. They're overly suspicious, even in the presence of a kindness being done to them. In verses 19 through 33, you have another demonstration, though, of their growing integrity. They approach the household steward, and they tell this story about how the money was accidentally given back to them. And they're obviously making some kind of overture to give the money back and make sure everything is on the up and up. Everything is made right. And once again, they are surprised by kindness. The household steward says, "I had your money before your God, the God of your father, but your God, the God of your fathers, has given it back to you." Now, I'm not sure what the household steward meant by that. I don't know whether he was a genuine worshiper of the God of Israel or whether he had simply seen his master in the household who was a worshiper of the God of Israel, or whether he's just speaking in kind of general religious language. But it was true what he said, whether he knew it or not. Their God had been kind to them. And he had extended that kindness to them through their brother. And so they are very well treated. You might say they are treated royally. In verse 24, we find that even their animals are cared for, those valuable donkeys they thought that Joseph would want. And when we get down to verse 25, to the end of the chapter, there are a number of noticeable events that take place. If you look at verses 26 to 28, twice we're told that they bow down. And once again, we are intended to understand that this is the fulfillment of Joseph's dreams. Dreams that occurred 20 years ago or more. God's revelation is coming true, and here the 11 brothers all bow down before him. Don't rush God. When God makes a promise, he will fulfill it, even though he may not let you know when. Decades have passed since that dream, and God is only now bringing it to fruition. Then, of course, we see Joseph's inquiry. He inquires after his father, and we see the emptiness of Joseph's heart, and we see how God is using this to cause Joseph to seek for and to long this and to long for this reconciliation. He wants to know if his father's still alive. Perfectly natural thing. He wants to have his mind and his heart set at ease. And here we see Joseph longing to know this and to be reunited with him, and perhaps for his father to be able to see what God has done. Can you imagine Joseph imagining that scene? Knowing that his father is a faithful follower of the Almighty God. Can you imagine Joseph anticipating that scene when his father will realize that he is still alive and his God has been faithful to him over all these years? Must have been something that Joseph longed for. And then we see Joseph inquiring about his brother Benjamin, and Moses even throws in the phrase, his mother's son, indicating the special nature of this relationship. And God's building a desire in Joseph's own heart to take the difficult and bitter steps that are necessary to effect a full reconciliation with his family, particularly with these brothers who desired to have him dead at one point. And of course, God's not done with the brothers either. When all is unveiled in God's providence, Joseph's brothers will be able to look back and see the consistent pattern of kindness that their estranged brother has performed for them, despite the fact that they were the ones who sold him into slavery. I think Jesus said something about piling ashes upon heads because of love and kindness that we demonstrate to people. This is an Old Testament example of that. In God's wisdom, in his providence, he is preparing the way for the reconciliation which is to come. God is wise, and we can trust his providence. There is not a person present in this encounter, who yet knows how this is going to all turn out, but God does. And those who are involved in this, Joseph and the brothers and Jacob, what are they doing? They're trusting. They're trusting in the God that they know for a result that they don't know. That's faith. That's faith. We are saved by grace through faith, and then we continue to walk by grace and in faith. Step by step by step, day by day by day, moment by moment by moment, trusting in the God that we know. And because we know him, we don't have to know the outcome. We don't have to know how the situations are going to turn out. We know the God who is God over the situation. And we trust him for his goodness and for his wisdom and for his providential care over his people. Amen. Father, thank you that you are a trustworthy God. You are faithful. You are a God of loving kindness. You are a God who does not change. We don't need to worry about whether or not your promises will still be true tomorrow. Cause us, Father, to live in the light of your holy, sovereign, gracious person. Cause us to live day by day, trusting you for what we cannot see. And as we do, Father, may that in and of itself be the means by which you are glorified in your people. For Christ's sake we ask it. Amen.